It's common knowledge now, almost like a joke, that movie trailers show just way too much. You finish a trailer and it's like, okay, well that's what the full story's gonna be. They even showed that a bunch of main characters are clearly not gonna survive. I don't even have to see this thing now. Movie trailers just shove spoilers in our faces. They're like, hey, do you like the big twist we just showed you? Well, be sure to come see it in theaters. You know, again.
Who'd have thought Darth Vader was Luke Skywalker's father?
Aww, thanks.
Like how a couple years ago, the second trailer for Terminator Genesis revealed that John Connor was a Terminator? That was in the trailer, and then they want you to go to the movie, and then the movie's gonna pretend like you don't know that's gonna happen.
You want to rent it, sir?
Why? I just saw the best part.
Like, what is this? Like, what is happening? Or like recently, the trailer for Spider-Man Far From Home, it started with a warning about Endgame spoilers. It was like, don't watch this trailer if you don't want to see Endgame spoilers. And then yeah, it did spoil stuff from Endgame, so thank you for the warning, but it also showed that MJ had figured out Peter Parker's identity. It's like, okay, so it's not cool to spoil stuff from other movies in this trailer, but it's cool to spoil this movie itself. Okay, I'm just trying to figure out the rules here. Once in a while on Reddit or Twitter or wherever you get internet stuff, you might see posts from people that are like, I stopped watching movie trailers and my movie going experience has improved so very much. And you know what? I totally believe that. I went to go see the movie Lion a couple years ago, not knowing anything other than the title. I thought maybe it was gonna be about lions. That was the one clue that I had, but then it wasn't about that, and it was delightful. I had no idea what it was gonna be about or what was gonna happen next. It was so much more engaging than a lot of movies I had seen in recent years. But a footnote of those posts about people not watching trailers anymore is that they usually admit that they probably miss out on some movies. Like some movies just don't even show up on their radar, or they never have the chance to develop an interest in seeing them. It's a kind of catch-22. It's helpful to watch movie trailers to see if you might be interested in watching the movies, but then movies can be so much more enjoyable without seeing trailers because they spoil so much. So why is it exactly that trailers are so spoiler heavy? Well, let's talk a little about how trailers come to be and who has a hand in making them, and why they make a lot of filmmakers pretty upset. Obviously, movie trailers are advertisements. They're designed to get people to go see movies. That is their main goal. And so right off the bat, you can probably see how it's tempting for studios to put the coolest stuff in their trailers. Like, hey, look at this amazing shot we spent a bunch of money on. This character blows up in an explosion. And yeah, that guy is the character's best friend and we're spoiling the fact that he dies, but look how cool this shot is. Please come see our movie. But decisions like that, like including shots like that, those aren't just made willy-nilly. And yeah, I said willy-nilly. We're gonna have to deal with the fact that I said that. I'm sorry. Movie trailers actually go through a rigorous testing period before being made public. Studios spend a whole lot of money, like hundreds of thousands of dollars on these things. They make a bunch of different trailers and test them with a bunch of different audiences. Like, they'll actually make different cuts that appeal to different audiences. Oh, here's an edit that'll probably appeal more to millennials. Alright, now let's make one that's targeted to baby boomers. Okay, boomer. According to Drew Cummins from BLT, an agency that actually makes movie trailers, one trailer can have like 50 versions, and as he told Marketplace.org in an interview, those are just the ones that make the cut. The studios then test these trailers in front of a bunch of different audiences and focus groups. They sit people down, they show them the trailers, and they ask them, would you see this movie based on this trailer? And a lot of the time, the feedback they get is that people say they want to know what they're buying, meaning they want to know a little bit more of the plot. So studios and editing houses have this line to toe where they need to show people enough to get them interested, but hopefully not reveal so much that they spoil the whole thing. Oftentimes, they fail in both directions. They show too much, or they don't show enough, and you're like, I don't know what this movie is supposed to be. And actually, a lot of filmmakers are pretty angry about how much trailers reveal as well. Imagine working for like a year of your life on a movie only to have the trailer reveal a major spoiler-heavy plot point. That's gotta suck. That's literally what happened to Matthew Vaughn, writer, director, producer of the Kingsman movies. If you haven't seen the Kingsman movies, I'm gonna talk about how the trailer spoiled something, so obviously I'm gonna talk about spoilers. So in the first movie, this awesome character named Harry, played by Colin Firth, ends up getting shot point blank in the head area, which is, you know, fatal a lot of the time. And in that movie, he was, for all intents and purposes, dead from there on out. The characters mourned him, and it played a big part in the plot. Then, a couple of years later, a trailer for Kingsman: The Golden Circle comes out. And at the end of it, they show that he's not dead. He has an eye patch now, but he's very much alive. So, yeah, Matthew Vaughn wasn't super happy. Here's what he told IGN about that move. He said, quote, "Well, I'm not in charge of marketing. The thinking about that was stupidity, to be blunt. I begged the studio not to reveal it. Because it's the whole driving force of the first act, and if you didn't know that scene, it would have made the whole audience gasp." So you have to ask the lovely marketing guys, because I think their job is to open the movie and don't really care about the experience of the movie. Yikes, that does sound like it sucks for Matthew Vaughn, and it sounds like it hits the nail on the head. The marketing people must have been like, well, people are gonna come see this movie if they know Harry's in it, so let's put him in the trailer. Even when it's not major, huge spoilers like that, it can still be very annoying for filmmakers. Like Colin Trevorrow, he was pretty unpleased that the trailer for the first Jurassic World movie showed a shot of Chris Pratt riding on a motorcycle with a bunch of raptors. Trevorrow basically said he's fully aware of what a ridiculous, insane image that is, but the film builds up to it. There's a lot of work that the movie does to get you to that point and make you accept seeing something ridiculous like that. Just showing that straight up in the trailer out of context takes away from that work that was put in. That being said, Jurassic World made $1.6 billion, so clearly it was some effective marketing, and if anything, it just reinforced Hollywood's notion of putting their best stuff in the trailers. It's the same reason why a lot of time if you go see a comedy movie, you come out and you're like, oh, well, all the funny stuff was in the trailers. And unfortunately, it's like, yeah, of course it was. If they want people to go see a funny movie, they need to show that the movie's funny, and the cost of that is showing their funniest stuff, and that means the audience has already seen some of the funniest things the film has to offer. Movie trailers in the past decade, and probably more than a decade, I don't have an exact timeline, they stopped using a major tool from their kind of movie promotional repertoire. Back in the 90s and even 2000s, movies used these movie trailer voice guys.
She's never been hip.
Don LaFontaine, Hal Douglas, and several other people with just golden voices. Their voice would pop into a movie trailer and just talk to you for a bit.
He was a gardener who only wanted one thing, a statue made of gold.
That's a horrible example, but you get what I'm talking about. These cool voice dudes served a really important purpose. They were a great way to give you important information quickly. Here are the rules of the movie universe, here's what the main character is like, and here's what he wants and what he's going up against. It's probably why so many of them started with "in a world." They tell you everything you need to know about the world real quick like, and now you know. Now you have the sales pitch. Are you in or are you out? But that style of movie trailers ended up, well, going out of style. It became such a fixture of pop culture that it ended up becoming a parody of itself and people started making fun of it. The trailer for Jerry Seinfeld's documentary Comedian, that was just straight up a send-up of those kinds of trailers. It took place in an actual voice booth with Hal Douglas.
In a world where laughter was king.
Stand-up comedian Pablo Francisco also had a super popular bit where he made fun of those movie trailer voices.
Is that guy making you breakfast in the morning?
Two eggs are beaten beyond recognition.
That video went viral before videos going viral was even really a thing. So eventually it became kind of a joke to do trailers in that style. And so for the most part, they stopped doing it.
You're fired.
You're fired.
No, you're actually fired.
I'm fired.
The problem with that is that they still need to set up the world and the rules of the world in like 2 minutes. Only now, they don't really have a choice but to explain it using actual movie dialogue and voiceovers from the actual movie. That makes it a whole lot easier to stumble into spoiler territory. What if the line of dialogue you need to set up the rules of the world is delivered by a character who's seconds away from dying? Well, I guess we'll have to reveal that because it's a really good exposition line. It's tough for movie studios to get people's butts into seats while also keeping keeping a lot of their movies' mysteries alive. If you've never tried to go to a movie without having seen the trailer, I do recommend giving it a shot. Pick a movie and avoid all trailers. Avoid all promotional images, all interviews, just shut it out. Just go see the movie. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised at how much more you actually enjoy it. This might be a weird example because a lot of people really dislike this movie, but imagine Batman v Superman. If the trailer hadn't shown us that Batman and Superman team up, that probably would have been a lot more satisfying to see. If the trailer and promotional material hadn't revealed Gal Gadot as Wonder Woman, it could have been insane to have this reveal that this mysterious woman throughout the movie is actually Wonder Woman. She would have shown up in her costume and everyone would have been like, oh my god. So give it a shot. Stop watching movie trailers. And with that said, I should also say, please don't stop watching movie trailers. We kind of do a lot of trailer breakdowns here at Screen Rant and theories about trailers and general videos where we dissect them. So please don't stop. Just keep watching those bad boys and spoiling it for yourself. That'd be super appreciated. Thank you so much. And thanks for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. What's your strategy when it comes to trailers? Are you the kind of person who just watches one and then that's it? Or do you consume everything you can relating to a movie until it comes out? Let me know your thoughts on that in the comment section. And also, if you feel like it, you can hit the like button and the subscribe button. As always, check back soon for a new video.
Bye-bye.